was in college, biology was absent from the study of human social behavior. And at this time, human motivation was assumed to be completely selfish, which means that compassionate motivation didn't exist. Not only did it not exist as a topic, but I believe that everyone that I ever worked with felt that that meant it didn't exist in human behavior, which means that you can't study compassionate motivation, or I couldn't. Or if you did, like in the case of Dan Batson, who we just heard from, if you did venture out and try to study compassion, you would be met with enormous challenges and obstacles and skepticism. Connecting biology to social behavior, however, was beginning to happen at that time, and the pioneers of that field are actually represented today on this panel. Their work led to a picture, and is leading, continues to lead, to a picture of motivational systems that are dedicated to and dependent on compassion, which paves the way now for science to study compassion. So it is with my deepest gratitude that I announce the members of today's panel and present them to you today: Stephen Cole, Stephen Porges, Sarina Saturn, and Sue Carter. So please give them a round of applause.
Steve Cole. I study the everyday life of the human genome, basically how the experiences we have on a daily basis regulate what our 20,000 human genes do. A lot of people in the genetics community think this is a pretty crazy preoccupation. They ask me why I do this kind of thing. And so I often show them data like this. This is a heat plot that shows the expression of about 200 genes assayed in white blood cells from people in an epidemiologic study, looking at basically a small group of people exposed to high levels of one of our most toxic environmental risk factors known to epidemiology, and another group exposed to relatively low levels of that risk factor. So in this heat plot, rows correspond to individuals in the study, columns correspond to one of about 200 genes that were found to show greater than 50% difference in average activity level or average RNA transcription level in the white blood cells from people exposed to high versus low levels of the risk factor. Columns correspond to the genes, rows to the individuals. To the extent that the cell formed by an intersection of the two is red, that means high expression of that gene in that person. To the extent that it's green, that means low expression in that person. So what you see here basically is a block of about 70 genes that are systematically more active in the white blood cells of people exposed to high levels of the risk factor, about 130 genes that are systematically less active in people exposed to high levels of the risk factor. So it turns out these 200 genes aren't a random smattering of all genes in the human genome, about 20,000 genes we have. They actually represent a few organized conspiracies. So in the 70 or so upregulated genes, for example, we see a big block of transcripts that are involved in inflammation, or the cell's first response to tissue injury and the initiation of an immune response. And prominent among the downregulated genes are blocks involved in defending us against intracellular pathogens, type 1 interferons, which protect us against viral infections, and genes involved in producing a particular type of antibody response. So this kind of coordinated shift in the immune system's basal level of activity, this kind of change in its, we could think of it as its basal transcriptional stance, I don't think would be too surprising to us if the kind of risk factor that we were looking at in this study were the kind of microbial or physicochemical threats that we, I think, mostly and intuitively worry most about in epidemiology. Things like benzene in the drinking water or Ebola virus on the person sitting in the chair next to you. But it turns out that the risk factor that's structuring these differences in gene expression is simply the extent to which the people in the first few rows of this heat plot feel disconnected from the rest of humanity. So it's loneliness that's actually the risk factor that seems to be prompting these differences in what our white blood cells are doing. They should be busy defending us against microbes. Apparently, they're listening to our social well-being as well. So this, I think, is a little bit of a surprise. It certainly surprised us when we found it. But as we've done more research on everyday life and its sort of shadow on our genome, what we find is that actually this is not particularly distinctive. It turns out a wide variety of different adverse life circumstances seem to activate this same gene transcriptional shift away from basically a response that's good at protecting us against socially mediated pathogens and toward a response that's basically bracing us for injury and the bacterial infections that come along with that. And in the last few years, we've learned a fair amount about how these kinds of gene expression changes come about. We know that they're mediated in large part by signals sent from the brain when we feel unsafe, threatened, uncertain, the activation of fight or flight stress responses, the release of norepinephrine from sympathetic nerve terminals throughout the body, including in organs where immune cells congregate. And those signals get picked up by receptors on the surface of white blood cells, like those beta adrenergic receptors there. And evolution has apparently programmed us when that signal gets sent through that particular receptor. There is essentially sort of a molecular wiring diagram within the cell that activates the genes involved in inflammatory responses in protecting us against cell injury and bacterial infections, and simultaneously suppresses the activity of the genes involved in defending us against viral infections. Now, it turns out that the psychology is key to this kind of, which you can think of as sort of molecular reflex response. If you had had a different experience of the world, if you weren't feeling threatened or uncertain, but instead felt profoundly overwhelmed and defeated, you would have what biologists call a defeat withdrawal response, which is characterized more strongly by activation of the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis, release of cortisol from your adrenal gland, and that engages receptors that execute a fundamentally different program. They actively repress the activity of these antiviral interferon genes, but they also strongly repress the activity of these pro-inflammatory genes. So different ways of experiencing everyday life, different ways of experiencing the world, especially connected to a sense of safety, security, embeddedness within a community, this, it turns out, hooks on to fundamental evolved regulatory architecture in our bodies that calls forth different responses from the menu of opportunities that are embedded in a 20,000 gene genome like ours. And it turns out that these dynamics are regulated not just by calling forth different gene transcriptional responses from the cells that already comprise our bodies, but it can actually start to reshape the cellular composition of our body. So here's one example. Many of the dynamics that I just talked to you about are mediated by a particular group of cells called monocytes, dendritic cells, collectively termed myeloid lineage immune cells. And one thing we know is that in people who are confronting adverse environments for long periods of time, the brain basically activates the sympathetic nervous system mediated fight or flight stress response over and over, usually at relatively low levels, but enough to actually result in the release of norepinephrine from these nerve terminals in the bone marrow. One of the things the bone marrow does is quite industriously producing new white blood cells all the time, because it turns out our white blood cells don't live very long. We constantly have to regenerate the cells that are essentially our immune system. So that cellular regeneration process is mediated by hematopoietic stem cells. And these stem cells, when they hear a signal from the sympathetic nervous system, when the receptors in their environment get activated and the signals get sent, that activates a program that causes them to lighten up on the production of big, smart lymphoid lineage immune cells like T cells and B cells, and to really invest more deeply in the production of these first line of defense myeloid lineage cells. So now we've got more monocytes and granulocytes being born in the bone marrow, and they then leave the bone marrow and circulate through our blood throughout our body. Now, that would be a great thing if we were running around when we're feeling threatened or uncertain, getting a lot of tissue injuries that lead to bacterial infections. But what happens when these cells go into systemic circulation If we don't have an injury, is you've got a lot of primed inflammatory cells basically looking to cause trouble. So now, if you have an initiated cancer and it starts to squash its neighbors, these myeloid lineage cells go in there, and in some misguided attempt to limit the growth of tissue injury or bacterial infection, they secrete growth factors, grow blood vessels into the environment, and by and large, promote metastasis completely incidentally. They also will get into damaged blood vessel lining and start to build a little plaque to protect the injured tissue. That ends up creating atherosclerosis and heart diseases. If you've got damaged neurons, you get more neurodegenerative diseases when you've got these primed myeloid lineage cells running around your body. So this, it turns out, accidentally, is a recipe for developing essentially every major chronic illness that shapes contemporary morbidity and mortality, the sort of, if you will, the epidemiology of modern life. So in some sense, you can think of this transcriptional reflex as sort of a recipe for how not to live, both figuratively in the sense that it gets evoked when you're feeling threatened or uncertain, but also literally in the sense that this stuff, this molecular byproduct, this shift in what the immune system is doing, essentially is fertilizer for the diseases that tend to kill us most often in the world that we now live in. So a few years ago, we started asking, well, we now have a good sense of what we don't want to be doing, the lives we don't want to lead. A reasonable question is, how should we make that go away? What's the best way to be not miserable in the sense that we actually see more favorable biology at this molecular level in our immune cells? So in a study that was done a couple years ago now, Barb Fredrickson's group was interested in two different types of being not miserable. It turns out that there's a version of being not miserable. If you were to go to most positive psychology researchers right now and say, what do we know about being not miserable? They'd say, well, look at this beautiful sunset and eat this tasty meal and listen to this beautiful music. Let's sort of orchestrate what they call largely hedonic well-being, the kind of well-being, the happiness that comes from essentially consuming wonderful stimuli. So you can think of this as sort of a kind of a reflex level happiness. Now, if on the other hand, you went to Aristotle or your grandmother, she'd say that stuff is cheap. That is too easy. That's empty calories happiness there. What you really want out of life is the deeper, more abiding happiness that comes from, not from feeling good, but from doing good, from making a contribution to humanity, from pursuing some noble, sort of goal or effort that transcends your own immediate self-interest and makes the world a better place, from dedicating your days to the betterment of some people in your family or a cause or a political movement or some change in the well-being of humanity as a whole. In other words, you want what Aristotle would have called eudaimonic well-being, the kind of well-being that is essentially more pro-social, more driven not by attention to the self and your interest, by attention to the outside world and the communities and people that you care about. So Barb's group collected gene expression data. They collected white blood cells from individuals who they measured for hedonic well-being with items like how often do you feel happy or satisfied with your life, and then items measuring eudaimonic well-being, like how often do you feel like you're life has a sense of direction and meaning, how often do you feel like you're growing and becoming a better person? So that gives you kind of a flavor of how they measure these two different types of well-being. So what we'd like to see in the white blood cells of people, if either of these versions are effective in sort of delivering us from the abject misery of threat and uncertainty in everyday life and actually structuring a world in our head and our daily experience that filters down into the molecular biology of our cells, what we'd like to see is a profile where we see comparatively high levels of expression of the gene transcripts in the upper left-hand corner there that encode interferon responses, comparatively high levels of gene transcripts encoding the particular antibodies that we're interested in, and relatively low expression of the gene transcripts in the lower left-hand corner that encode these pro-inflammatory cytokines. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to flip some axes around, rotate that on its side, so that in general, if we're seeing a good gene expression dynamic, we'll see sort of a net vector upwards in space toward the favorable direction at the top of the slide. If we're seeing, on the whole, relatively high levels of inflammation and low levels of these antibody and interferon-related gene transcripts, we'll see an arrow pointed largely down. So, showing that your grandmother and Aristotle actually did know what they're talking about, when we look at people who have relatively high levels of eudaimonic well-being, they show an excursion in a pretty favorable direction, relatively low levels of inflammatory gene expression and quite pronounced high levels of antiviral gene transcripts. When we looked at people who had comparatively high levels of hedonic well-being, or you can think of it as hedonic well-being that doesn't seem to have derived predominantly from eudaimonic sources, what we see is a surprisingly unfavorable vector. In fact, on the whole, more inflammatory biology, somewhat less interferon and antibody-related gene expression. So this is an interesting result if we sort of think about whether everything we feel directly filters down into our bodies. Because it turns out if you ask these two different types of people, people with high levels of one versus the other kind of well-being, whether they're feeling happy, it turns out they both report similarly low levels of depressive symptoms and generally positive affect. But when you look at the molecular biology going on inside their cells, things look quite a bit different. Now, how can this come about? Where in this whole system that I talked to you about earlier, this wiring diagram that maps experience onto biology, do we get some kind of biochemical signal of eudaimonic well-being? What we're beginning to suspect from the accumulating evidence that's emerged in the last couple of years since this study was initially done is that probably what's happening is there is a wing of the autonomic nervous system that can countermand this fight-or-flight stress response from the sympathetic division of the nervous system. And it looks as though what's happening is when people attend to the outside world, when they attend to people they care about, when they essentially operate in a compassionate mode in their daily life, they're activating a fundamentally conserved biological response that has the effect of inhibiting this fight-or-flight stress biology that's orchestrating these adverse gene expression profiles. So we'll hear quite a lot about that in the next presentation, I believe. There are other ways to activate the parasympathetic nervous system besides just doing good for people. You can also, it looks like, cultivate many of the same kinds of biological responses through contemplative practices, meditation. There's a number of studies now showing favorable changes in gene expression in randomized controlled experiments that appear to, in some sense, at least quantitatively, reverse these effects associated with adverse biology. So as we think, as scientists, mostly about bodies as fundamentally unitary, systems separated from the rest of humanity. In fact, what we're learning is that our biology is intrinsically bound up in the people around us, our relationships to them, and the way that shapes how we function at the physiologic level. And with that, I will conclude and serve as an introduction to Steve's next presentation.
Well, thank you for the introduction. I decided to take some notes during the presentations, and so I don't want to forget what I'm going to talk about, which is about four words. And it really is that we want to really emphasize that physiology is an intervening variable. So that when we talk about training compassion or doing any type of manipulation, a lot has to do with the existing physiological state the individual is in. And what I'm going to be talking about is physiological states lead to emergent properties, and some of those emergent properties are feelings of compassion and empathy. And just as Steve was saying, I'm going to be basically emphasizing that the physiological state that enables these emergent properties is actually a state of parasympathetic control mediated by a unique vagal pathway that is unique to mammals. And this vagal pathway can be accessed through certain types of voluntary behaviors, through spontaneous social interactions with the emergent properties of basically downregulating stress responses and facilitating health. So the actual theme of the talk is that we know a lot. We don't know it really from physiology, and we don't know it from psychology from our research, but we actually know it from ancient practice. And so the basic talk is really to say that embedded in religious and spiritual practices for hundreds of years have been manipulations of vagal pathways. We haven't called it manipulations of vagal pathways, we've called it religious rituals. These manipulations are really manipulations of vocalizations, breath, and posture. And each of these manipulations actually triggers a specific vagal pathway that is linked to downregulating defensiveness. And if we think about what is a major component of being in a state, being present and being mindful, it's really turning off defenses. We use the word being evaluative, but what we're really saying is we're not in a defensive state. And when we're not in a defensive state, we really are connected. And there's another component that I normally talk about, which is something I call connectedness as a biological imperative. Mammals, and especially mammals like us, cannot survive by ourselves. We can't regulate our physiology as an individual. We need other individuals, and perhaps some of us can even get along with another appropriate mammal, which may be your dog. But it may not be the best, but it certainly is good. Anyway, posture and basically these exercises of vocalization, breath, and posture are functionally neural exercises, and they exercise specific vagal pathways that are not merely promoting portals to compassion, but they're portals to health, growth, and restoration. And I think this was really the theme of Steve's talk as well. So we're going to start off with merely looking at some pictures. This talk is really quite visual. It's not really dense on the physiology. But the first thing is we have to look at the whole concepts of vocalizations and the fact that vocalizations have been part of religious practice, regardless of what the religion is. We also know that if you want to calm a baby, the singing of a mother's lullaby is very, very profound. Yet the voice of the father, which is less melodic but with lower frequencies, triggers in infants often a reaction of predator, which is really the impact of low-frequency sounds. So many fathers are actually distanced by their kids who are frightened by them. And if you talk to parents of autistic children, they will tell you that their kid or their son is frightened by the father's voice. The fix for that is just to speak in a falsetto. So the issue is melodic voices trigger what I call feature detectors, or another word I use is neuroception, that trigger safety. So we can use this as, in the sense of what was brought up earlier, it's not a learned behavior. Our nervous system is prepared to respond to these features if the features are presented in our environment. And actually, religion has already understood this in terms of the types of songs and singing that's part of it. And again, if you look at the monk's mouth, you see the movement of the striated muscles of the face, and you can hear the words coming out. And the point that I also want to make at this point is that the neuroregulation of the face, the mouth, the oral area, the eyes, and even controlling muscles of the middle ear that enable us to hear human voice and dampen background sounds are related to the vagal regulation of our heart. So when we do these behaviors, when we sing, we're enhancing the regulation of our heart through this vagal pathway. And of course, it crosses religions. And we can now move to the second major neural exercise, and that is breath. And of course, within meditation, even the metaphors that we breathe in the suffering or pain, and we exhale with love. Well, actually, what we really are doing is, during the exhalation phase, the influence of the vagus on the heart is pronounced, and during the inhalation, it's turned off. So if we sing, we're always extending the duration of our exhalation. If we play wind instruments, we do this. And I often do a little experiment in my workshops. I have people inhale with a long inhalation and a short exhalation. I do this repeatedly without hyperventilation, and then I reverse it with rapid inhalations and slow exhalations, and then they are actually working in a dyad, and they have to report how they perceive the other person and how that person perceives them. And of course, about 80% of the people see a loving person across from them when they extend the exhalation. They say, I want to meet that people, I want to know that person better. But when they do the long inhalation, short exhalations, they look at the person, they say, did I do something wrong? Did I not follow the instructions correctly? So they have manipulated their physiological state by breathing. And of course, this is embedded in pranayama yoga, and we can see it also in the postures. And now we're going to get to the mechanisms underneath this in a moment. But in postures, of course, in Islamic, people are bowing. And of course, we create metaphors of exaltation and, in a sense, reverence. But I'm going to tell you that these things are more than that. They're actually physiological exercises. And this is from Islam. And this is Orthodox Judaism, which also has some of those same features of bending, bowing, and even in Christianity. And I used to have a picture behind this, but I realized this was a very respectful crowd. It was of Tim Tebow, so who actually was going into the exact same posture. But now we want to decompose this and try to understand really what's going on. When we have this melodic, prosodic vocalizations that are conveying to the other person safety and calmness, like a mother's lullaby, this is actually a reflection of a neuroregulation through laryngeal nerves. And those laryngeal nerves are actually vagal nerves. And they are actually monitoring or basically manifesting the physiological state of the person vocalizing. So long before we had syntax or words, we had vocalizations. And the vocalizations served a functional adaptive purpose in the survival of mammals. They triggered in the other mammal that they were safe to come close to. So we now live in a world where we're dominated by syntax and meaning of word, including a lot of this research, the research going on compassion, when it's really not the words, it's really how the words are articulated and the prosodic features, because that's our biology. And our biology conveys the loving kindness of our speech, which is really the loving kindness of our body. And as we increase the duration of exhalation with vocalizations, we enhance the vagal break on the heart. We calm our body down, and we also downregulate those sympathetic defensiveness. We don't turn the sympathetic nervous system off. We utilize it for our benefit. We don't use it as a defense system. And breathing, of course, is the primary one that we can both voluntarily do and involuntarily do. And when we do it voluntarily, we actually do that manipulation of the vagus. We turn on and off the vagal break. And posture is another critical one, because posture changes the position of our blood pressure receptors, primarily the ones in our neck. And as we bow, we trigger physiological responses through a reflex called the baroreceptor reflex, which changes the vagal activity. Now, when we were in graduate school or college, we learned about the autonomic nervous system, and we tended to think of it solely as a system of paired antagonism. You have this wonderful parasympathetic nervous system that supports growth, health, and restoration, and you have the sympathetic, which is kind of this diabolical defense system. That conceptualization is not appropriate because the system doesn't react to the world as a paired antagonistic system. It actually reacts hierarchically. And what we needed to understand was that we didn't have one vagus. We had two different vagal circuits. We had one that was above the diaphragm, that dotted line, and that one included pathways that regulated vocalizations and regulated posture. And this was this beneficial one that downregulated sympathetic activity, but it's beneficial only in the context of safety, because if you downregulate your sympathetics in a dangerous situation, you're going to be injured. But what we forgot about was that the vagus was not a single pathway. It was a conduit with lots and lots of cables. And some of those cables were very, very old and went subdiaphragmatically. They went below the diaphragm and they controlled our gut. And this system was used by phylogenetically more primitive animals as a defense system. So if we look at reptiles, what's their defense? It's to immobilize. And what do reptiles do when they immobilize? They will defecate. They will reduce their metabolic demands. And what's one of the fear responses that humans have, especially in a function of trauma or severe isolation? They'll have gut issues. They'll defecate. They'll pass out. And some of the fibers that the reptiles had going to their heart still remain in the human. And those were fibers of this unmyelinated old vagus, which really slowed the heart rate up. So when a reptile was basically trying to immobilize, it stopped breathing, it lowered its heart rate, and it reduced its metabolic demands. And in fact, mammals do this as defense. So the vagus is not all a positive system for health, growth, and restoration. But you can see the pathways in the vagus that goes above the diaphragm that are involved in posture, vocalizations, and breathing. And this is a myelinated, uniquely mammalian vagus. But we have to remember that not all vagal pathways support social communication. They don't all downregulate stress responses of the sympathetic nervous system. They're not all indicators or support resilience and compassion. There are vagal pathways that are defensive and potentially lethal. So we have to be more specific in understanding what we're dealing with. But I don't want you to look at the cat. I want you to look at the mouse in the jaws of the cat. And you'll see that that mouse is limp. That mouse has basically passed out. We use the word death feigning, but it is not a voluntary behavior. It's an involuntary behavior because that mouse has detected through involuntary mechanisms or through mechanisms without awareness that this is an unavoidable life-threat situation. And so there's adaptive features. If that animal is going to be eaten, he's not going to feel the pain. And perhaps the animal will still survive because the cat will lose interest. But the main point here is that the vagus is not just a nerve of compassion and a portal for good things. It's also a nerve that has different adaptive functions and different pathways. So we need to think of the autonomic nervous system as a hierarchical system that reacts in a predictable way. And this is really this theory that I developed which I call the polyvagal theory, to emphasize that there are more than one vagal pathway. And the theory describes three neural circuits that form a phylogenetically ordered response hierarchy. And breaking that down, it really means we use our newest circuits first, and when they don't help us, we use our oldest. And the newest one is really adaptive to safety and social interaction. And when that doesn't work, then that's that new mammalian myelinate vagus. We then move into this sympathetic nervous system for defense. But if the defense of mobilization doesn't get us into a safe place, our nervous system may go into a life threat response like that mouse. And basically, you can see this hierarchical system, which could be described as polyvagal states and actually defines the polyvagal theory, and that is this myelinated supradiaphragmatic vagus, which is above the diaphragm, is the one that's accessed through a breath, through posture, and through vocalizations, and this has the ability to downregulate the sympathetic nervous system, just like Steve was describing in his talk, to support our health, growth, and restoration. And when the sympathetic nervous system as a defense system doesn't really serve its purpose to put us in safety, then this shutdown response will occur. And what research is now showing that even markers for cancer or cancer stages, that if you have really a strong or well-functioning myelinated vagus, cancer stage is less predictive of outcome than if you have a low vagal regulation through the heart. And there's research even on prostate cancer now showing that the subdiaphragmatic autonomic neurons are embedded in actually the functioning and development of various aspects of cancer. So what we really want is this supradiaphragmatic vagus to work, to function, and this is how prayers and chants will work, to downregulate the sympathetic nervous system, the HPA axis, to allow the subdiaphragmatic organs to be in balance now, subdiaphragmatically, using both sympathetic and parasympathetic systems to promote health, growth, and restoration. So if treated as a hierarchical system, then vagal manipulations via prayer, meditation, and chants involving vocalizations, breath, and posture are both efficient and neurophysiologically sound strategies that are capable of turning off both sympathetic and vagal pathways of defense. Thank you.
Our next speaker will be Sarina Saturn.
Hi, everyone. I'm here to tell you about moral elevation, which is a specific emotional state that we experience when we're witnessing profound virtue. Elicitors of motivation come in a variety of flavors, but it's really when the actions of other people have great moral beauty and intense integrity. And moral elevation can be elicited by unexpected benevolence, the expression of gratitude toward complete strangers, kind-heartedness, and that sort of thing. This idea of moral elevation has been around for centuries, and Thomas Jefferson even characterized it, this advocation for the value of reading stories of people that display great moral selflessness. His quote states, when any act of charity or of gratitude, for instance, is presented either to our sight or imagination, we are deeply impressed with its beauty and feel a strong desire in ourselves of doing charitable and grateful acts also. We know what moral exemplars are all about. These are people who immediately come to mind for their displays of amazing moral excellence, and we're very, very moved by their virtue. Yet neuroscience and psychology have relatively little to say about these other praising emotions as compared to what they have to say about other emotional states. Now, we can compare elevation to other emotions in that elevation motivates pro-social and affiliative behavior, and I'll expand on this idea later. And that's different from gratitude, which is essentially motivating improved relationships with benefactors, often involving this very personal exchange and this desire to pay someone back. Also different from admiration, which is basically motivating us for self-improvement, and happiness, which is this progress towards or achieving a personal goal. Unique to moral elevation is this experiential effect, which includes feeling very uplifted and compassionate, and really having this optimism towards humanity amplified, and really creating this desire in ourselves to become better people. It also is accompanied by physical sensations such as a warmth in the chest, a lump in the throat, and tears in the eyes. And behaviorally, elevation has been shown to increase altruistic helping behavior. Elevation is part of what we call the awe family of emotions, which may be vast and require mental accommodation. And awe comes in a variety of flavors. There can be awe of threat, such as a huge fire or a big tsunami wave coming towards us. Awe of beauty, whether it be of Mother Nature or of another person. Skill or talent, which is what I feel for everyone here on this stage right now. Virtue, which I'm expanding on today. And some of us feel virtue from supernatural or religious entities. I'm from Oregon, and there's a lot of natural beauty around me, so hopefully most of us feel a lot of awe. This is sunset at Crater Lake when we're viewing the ocean or waterfalls or a deep forest and whatever might move you. But what's specific to moral elevation compared to these other brands of awe is that it requires mental accommodation and that we basically have to shift our conception of the world. And also, it's all about virtue. Now, previous work on moral elevation has shown that it does increase altruism, as I mentioned. And what's really interesting is that the degree of altruism expressed in these experiments would directly correlate with people's experience of moral elevation, their self-reports of wanting to help other people, and how much they felt in their body as well, such as the warmth in the chest. We were really inspired by the study that induced moral elevation in nursing mothers who brought their babies to the lab. And after elevation induction, these mothers experienced more milk letdown, and we've known for a long time in the field that oxytocin is really key for the milk letdown response. And they were actually more affectionate towards their children. And this is a big clue, thanks to the pioneering work of Sue Carter and others, that oxytocin, which is a neurotransmitter and hormone release, really key for social bonds and affiliative behaviors, that this may be released during moral elevation as well. So we're starting out to characterize the biology underlying elevation. And just to give you a flavor, I'll show you a video clip of the one of the stimuli that we use in our study. It was also used in the lactating study and the altruism study as well.
Marcellus doesn't know the real reason he's here. Is because someone he inspired wants to pay tribute to you. Someone you inspired wants to pay tribute to you. Take a look.
Marcellus Brown. You know, I thought he was like one of the coolest people that I had ever met. He treated me like a human being that had the potential to grow. So, you know, I was inspired to be just like him. What Marcellus did to me, he saved my life. I grew up in Chicago on the West Side. My most vivid memory is trying to make mud pies and feed them to my sisters because there was no food in the house. And I've gone down the street begging neighbors for food. I just felt like I had to run and hide in shame most of my entire life. I've seen people murdered. I bought a gun. I thought I was going to be a drug dealer.
But one day, while visiting a friend at Chicago State University, Fernando had a chance meeting with Marcellus Brown, the school's band director. It was an encounter that would change the course of Fernando's life. Marcellus heard him play the trumpet and offered him a scholarship.
I was just so excited that Marcellus would take the time and show some interest in me that I said, okay, I want to go to college.
But Marcellus didn't just help Fernando with his music.
Marcellus was my first father figure. He inspired me. He showed me how to write. He showed me how to eat at a table, you know, what utensils to use. He knows the right words to touch a person to motivate them to do what they need to do.
After graduation, Fernando moved to Los Angeles and began to make a career for himself as a musician.
I played with some of the artists that I just dreamed about. Played on the Tonight Show, Saturday Night Live. I just had a great time, but my real passion was teaching, and I really wanted to be able to give people what I was given.
Fernando left.
Okay, so that's just a snippet from the elevation video, just to give you a flavor of how they induce elevation in the laboratory and how we do as well, and we use other stimuli as well. And we're very inspired by polyvagal theory, as Steve Porges went over, which really emphasizes these phylogenetic stages in our development of our autonomic nervous system. And we're particularly interested in this myelinated branch, which he mentioned, which is all about social connections and calming behavioral states by dampening the HPA axis. And it can affect respiratory sinus arrhythmia, which is basically an index of high-frequency heart rate variability, this vagal break. And as Dr. Porges mentioned, we have our sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous systems, and in high school and biology 101, we kind of miss the nuance of how these two operate in our systems. We are particularly interested in how the sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system affect the heart in various different ways. This is just basically showing how they innervate the heart. There's a sinoatrial node, SA, pacemaker of the heart, and we know that the vagal break will actually help slow down the heart to calm it down, especially to promote social affiliation, and the sympathetic nervous system will cause this increase in heart rate in order to rise to the occasion when we're feeling stressed and threatened. So to do our experiment, we have a neutral baseline, and then we induce elevation in one population of our participants, and we use amusement. We want to use a positive control that's also social in order to really tease out what's unique about this emotional state. So I'm going to show you a clip from that stimulus. And just a reminder that we look at physiological recordings when we have individuals in the laboratory, both to monitor their parasympathetic and sympathetic arousal. Not just looking at heart rate and heart rate variability, but we also look at skin conductance and some other measures as well.
Nighttime. Daytime. Nighttime. Daytime. Nighttime. Daytime.
What are you doing?
Having a game in nighttime, daytime. You want to play?
I don't know why, but I don't seem to have a lot of luck with women. I mean, I'm kind, I'm caring, I'm... No, it's a mystery, that.
Alan! 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 Al! Alan!
She's all neck and legs. Look at her.
Oh, I am looking at her.
Stop looking at her!
You just told me to look at her!
Ow!
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 Ow! I was trying to be cruel, that.
John, I don't think we're allowed to wear.
It's fine. Just keep a lookout. What was that? That was me zip. Whoa! Where did all these come from? You know me, lads. I can't wait with an audience. Alan! 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 Alan!
I'm Wolverine!
I'm Sabretooth!
Wolverine!
Sabretooth!
Wolverine!
Sabretooth!
Wolverine!
Sabretooth!
You can't get me, I'm Wolverine!
I'm Sabretooth!
Pack it in. You know I'm working nights.
Cheer up, Trev. I'm all right, Bernie. Here, catch for you. This fella and a giraffe walk into a bar. Giraffe goes to sleep on the floor. Farmer says, oi, what's that lion there? Fella says, it's not a lion, it's a giraffe. Giraffe! You crap me up, Trev.
You just like to open wide, sir.
Okay.
Are you going anywhere nice on your holidays?
I think...
Yeah, don't try and talk when my hands are in your mouth, sir. My wife and I are thinking of going abroad this year. Dudley. She's got family in the zoo over there. You got kids? Please don't talk when my hands are in your mouth, sir. I could do the fill-in here, actually, at the back. Is it mainly bananas you eat?
Bananas, yeah.
I won't tell you again, sir. Please don't try and speak when I'm working inside your mouth. Right, I'm sure you have a cheeky little taste. That's not bad, actually. Not what's done, just need to smell your breath. Oh, God, that is rank. I think I need to lie down.
All right, so I wanted to spend a chunk of my time here to show you that in order for you to just kind of reflect a bit on how that feels very differently in your body and in your brain. They're both feel-good emotional states, but moral elevation is very different than amusement. And what we essentially found is that elevation can significantly boost vagal tone, respiratory sinus arrhythmia, that vagal break. And that's very, very significant, especially compared to the amusement group. Interestingly, we also saw an amplification of the sympathetic nervous system as well. We saw an increase in heart rate and also an increase in skin conductance. And so we basically saw a dual activation of the autonomic nervous system. And although uncommon, we do see dual activation of the autonomic nervous system in situations that involve both social sensitivity and this arousal to rise to the occasion. Sue Carter's work has shown that it relates to caring for infants. We also know it's key for sexual activity and crying as well. We also looked at the medial prefrontal cortex, which is relevant both to autonomic nervous system regulation, social cognition, and emotion regulation. And previous work has shown that this does relate. We see patterns of activity where the medial prefrontal cortex activity will relate to what's happening in the vagus nerve. We use functional near-infrared spectroscopy that works on the same principles as functional magnetic resonance imaging, and that we're looking at blood flow oxygenation in the brain. And what we find is a decrease in medial prefrontal cortex activity during the induction of moral elevation. And this deactivation that we see in participants will directly relate to their inspiration, their admiration, and how much sympathy and compassion that they report feeling, and also this desire to help other people. Can think of the medial prefrontal cortex of our third eye, as you will. We know it's a double-edged sword in that it's allowed us to be very sophisticated, fancy monkeys, but can also tie up our ego. It's very much involved in social evaluations, especially when we're feeling very self-conscious, our judgment of others, and also time travel, the human propensity to relive the past or worry about the future. And so it seems that this decrease might relate to kind of untangling ourselves from those emotional states in order to let the emotions wash all over us. And we know the prefrontal cortex activity is also key in regulating the amygdala responsivity to emotional stimuli. We're really interested in affection, and just a teaser, that people who receive affection are actually more likely to experience elevation in a really magnificent way, where they feel more warmth and admiration and hope. We also do these experiments where we induce elevation and look how much they help afterwards, and it's the people who are getting affection in their daily lives that are more likely to help in this task. And for future directions, we're going to be measuring oxytocin levels before, during, and after elevation and collaborating with Sue Carter, and also look at oxytocin's relationship to autonomic profiles and neural processing. So with that, I'd like to thank all the people that made this conference and my work possible, and all of you for your attention.
Our next speaker will be Sue Carter.
It's a pleasure to be here. I want to thank both my sort of classmates on the dais and also, of course, the Compassion Care Group for bringing us here. This is a very important meeting. I love these. I've been to a couple. When we talk about abstract concepts like compassion and love, these are most easily understood in terms of survival and reproduction. Survival, the first law of nature, reproduction, sort of another first law of nature. We have to keep in mind that our survival is dependent on other. Sociality has both survival benefits, there's safety in numbers. And when we understand that, then everything else we've talked about here makes sense. Most living organisms, even bacteria, cannot survive or reproduce alone. The mammalian nervous system is a particularly intense example of the need for other, what Myron Hofer called hidden regulators exist. How do we know? We know mainly by what happens when they're gone. In the absence of other or in isolation, we see increases in drug abuse, food, mental, physical illness. We may even see if it's a long-lasting chronic experience, it can result in depression, shutdown, even death. Social stimuli can come from various sources, including partners. For those who don't know, this gentleman on the left is my husband, and these are our two children. Social bonds and, support are not one-way streets. The best relationships are reciprocal. This is our son, Eric, on 4th of July, carrying his, what was then newly rescued dog, and there was fireworks, and the dog refused to walk, so he had to carry the 60-pound dog home. But there's a give back. The dog gives back, as I think several people have mentioned. I think the evolutionary prototype for compassion and for love, in mammals at least, is the mother-child interaction. You can see it in the faces, in the social engagement system. Care of infants is not limited to mothers. It's not limited to biological offspring or relatives. Of course, not everyone's... I'm sorry. Not everyone's prepared to be a parent, and some of us may need hormonal help. A lot of research now, hundreds, really, I'm very pleased to say, many, many experiments from many sources have shown that the biology of social behavior, social bonds, social support, sexual behavior, all of these focus around one small molecule, neuropeptide known as oxytocin. I try to simplify this by saying that oxytocin is probably a physiological metaphor for safety. It permits and encourages social behavior and health, and of course has consequences for the big things, survival, reproduction, and evolution of modern humans. To understand human behavior, you have to realize that before modern times, breastfeeding was the only viable method for nourishing newborns, and humans and other mammals. Oxytocin is essential for lactation. It's important to birth, especially in humans, because we have a very big head and an extended dependency on mothers or others, a term that comes from Sarah Hurdy, who has written a lovely book about this. What lactation does, a very interesting process, because it allows the mother to manage stress more effectively, to be less reactive or more appropriately reactive to stressors, including stressful stimuli associated with childbirth. And it's also a buffer between the extreme physiological changes that occur during pregnancy and the postpartum period. Just a couple of examples. These are blood pressure measures from individuals who either controls the follicular phase, breastfeeding women who are the same, or bottle feeding women who have a bit higher blood pressure. And this has been replicated. We did this in 2001, Marty Altimus, my collaborator here, and this has been replicated now by several labs. If you put an individual in the face of a stressor, in this case it was a treadmill, you see more reactivity in the people who are bottle feeding. Just confirming. Interestingly, breastfeeding women do have reactivity in the immune system, and in fact are probably better able to deal with certain kinds of immune challenges. Oxytocin is a very simple molecule. It has 9 amino acids, a ring and a tail. It was originally thought to be a female reproductive hormone. This was a sort of factor, I think, that kept oxytocin from being seriously studied for a long time, because people really thought it was only in women, and therefore it couldn't be all that important. It is found in men in equal amounts, so congratulations, guys. You're still here for the same reason all of us are. But its targets are probably different in men and women, especially, of course, uterus and mammary glands. In fact, the targets that we're really interested in many cases, at least at a meeting like this, are the brain, and the brain is bathed in oxytocin. It comes out in extremely high levels, directly into the nervous system as well as into the bloodstream. It can affect social behavior, but it also affects autonomic nervous system and the immune system. Allows the body to adapt, protect, and heal itself in the face of challenge. Oxytocin also permitted the evolution of modern humans. In the transition from reptiles, represented here by a crocodile, but that really should be a turtle, because that's thought to be our most recent reptilian ancestor, you see that as the brain got bigger, we encountered more and more problems, mostly around the issues of raising babies, birth, and so forth. In this process, oxytocin, which not only allows the transition from reptile to mammal, those are Steve's words, it permits birth, it expels the large-brained baby from the uterus, provides nutrition, supports the baby, and it permits human social behavior and cognition. The human represents a particularly big challenge because we walk upright, we have a rigid pelvis that allows our legs to move in that way. We had to have help to get the baby out. So this big-headed baby comes out with some difficulty. I like this, if you can't see too well, but she's smiling, so I think this is a staged picture. But she really starts to smile afterward, and of course, oxytocin does all of these things. It's pretty close to a miracle. It has a partner in crime, though. That partner is arginine vasopressin. It's too complicated to explain all of the functions, but basically, vasopressin's involved in defensiveness, in protecting ourselves in an active way from challenge. It's very important to the parasympathetic nervous system. Oxytocin has a very different pattern of effects. It's involved in sharing behaviors, likely what we're calling compassion, but I hesitate to try to define that here. Relaxation, recovery, these again are Porges words, so I have them in quotes, immobility without fear, safety in the arms of another. Now, oxytocin and vasopressin do a dynamic dance with each other, and I won't go through all the details, but vigilance, hypermobilization, territoriality, arousal, all of these have adaptive functions. These are all good things, but you also need to be able to relax to show empathy, compassion, relaxation. The other amazing thing about oxytocin, and this now has been shown by, as I've said, hundreds of researchers, is that it allows social engagement, feelings of trust, connectedness, increased activity in regions of the brain involved with social behavior, and in some way decreases fear, it makes us socially brave. Oxytocin also has a direct role in healing. This has even been shown in tissue culture outside of the body. These are just a small list of things that have been shown. It can improve healing after burns, after cardiac infarcts, osteoporosis, intestinal bowel disease, stroke, anxiety, depression, autism, schizophrenia. And it will not surprise you, if you were listening to Steve Cole's talk, that this is an anti-inflammatory, antioxidant molecule. So how did we study these? We've done most of this work in small rodents. This is my favorite example, the prairie vole, which is socially monogamous. They have a lot of traits that are common to humans. Oxytocin is released under conditions like social engagement, maternal behavior, paternal behavior, allopaternal behavior, and sexual behavior. Just one data example, this is the in males, we didn't see this in females. If you put a baby in front of a male, he releases oxytocin. It's a very quick change. Any of you who want to study oxytocin, be sure to talk to me before you start, because time matters. When exactly you do these studies matters a lot in what you see. Oxytocin then feeds back and itself facilitates the parental behavior, and alloparental meaning care of others, pup retrieval, that sort of thing. But oxytocin is not just released under positive conditions, it's also released under in social interactions that are threatening. In fact, my guess is the best way to get oxytocin out of any given situation is something bad happening, probably so serving as a component of coping and buffering against the stressors. I'll just sum this up by saying oxytocin is involved with a sense of safety, and it probably allows the central nervous system to let us feel safe. It explains a lot of human behavior, including our capacity to heal in the presence of perceived social support. So what is oxytocin? I think it's a metaphor for safety. However, it's the tip of a physiological iceberg. It's not easy to study, but it has effects throughout the entire body. I don't think there's any tissue that isn't affected by it. I am finished early. I talked very fast, and I thank you.
Okay, I think what we'll do is just take questions for everyone, and at whenever it seems appropriate. So we'll go ahead and start with you.
So this is a question following from the last talk about oxytocin. Do we know whether compassion training leads to elevated release of oxytocin? And a second question would be, if oxytocin does all these good things, I know you also mentioned it's involved in inverted commas, bad things, what are your thoughts about the pharmacological use of synthetic oxytocin in certain situations?
I don't know. Does anybody here know if it's been done? Someone in the room should know. Specifically, compassion training. Where's Jim? We'll do it anytime you want to. The second question, I'm very concerned about the use of exogenous oxytocin. It won't surprise you. I mean, this system has feedback loops in it. If you put in a lot, there's a pretty good chance the body's going to adjust. It does have some peculiar characteristics, so that a little bit, an acute use of oxytocin, my guess is fairly safe. It's the chronic use I would worry about. Since I had 2 minutes left up there, I'll tell you about the lady from Marin County who showed up, no names, I hope she's in the room, and started telling me about using oxytocin for 10 months. And you say, why did she stop? Well, she was having the best time of her life. She had her first satisfying relationship, she claimed. She was in love. She stopped because she lost her memory, okay? Now, I'm not guaranteeing that would happen to everyone, but there's an old literature from 1970 shows that oxytocin can have an amnesic effect. This could be beneficial if you just gave birth to a baby, and preferred not to remember all the details of that. But, and it is an analgesic, I might not have mentioned that, but it's analgesic and amnesic under some conditions. I do not recommend the use of oxytocin as a chronic treatment. I don't think being in small experiments with single exposures is at all dangerous, but I'd be very careful about chronic use.
I'm Ivan Komarov. I've listened about a study from Tanya Singer, which is a neuroscientist of Max Planck Institute of Leipzig in Germany. And she made, with a group test, a group who is meditating, and a group who was meditating with compassion exercises. And she made a demonstration that the stress response for the group test was decreasing with meditation. It was completely uncorrelated with people who meditate and who follow compassion exercises. So it's Tanya Singer. Perhaps you will find it.
Question is for Stephen Porges. You talked about meditation and religious practice as increasing vagal tone in an advantageous direction. I'm wondering whether simple relaxation, it's often thought of differently, but whether it actually overlaps considerably in that way.
There are many ways of triggering the neuroregulation of the vagus to increase the state of safety, calmness, and functionally expansive feelings and thoughts. So remember that even meditation training for some people, if it's done in certain contexts, doesn't have the end result of making people feel safer or more comfortable. So there are various pathways to get to this.
My question is also for Dr. Porges. If you could project forward and imagine what future directions of research built upon your existing PVT work would be, what would you hope to see this work contribute to, particularly for my own aims in the work field of trauma, for example? I'm curious what applications you would like to see funded and explored moving forward.
Okay. What the theory explains to us is really how poorly we have evolved to deal with life threat situations, that even though we'll survive, if that's very adaptive, our nervous system does not efficiently move back into normalized behavior of social engagement. While our nervous system is very, very efficient in moving from fight to flight, fight flight into a social behavior. And that's because of the whole evolution of the species. So I see there's a tremendous responsibility in our society to understand that life threat features, whether we bomb cultures or make people fearful that they won't be able to pay their mortgage or have their food, or in a sense the way we treat children in school where we have armed guards, where we create a context of life threat, that we are potentially epigenetically changing the physiology and interfering with the efficient mechanisms that we evolved to move from fight flight to social engagement. In a sense, we're creating an environment of shutting down. And I think this is part of why many of you are here, that you feel and sense the lack of connectedness in the world, and your effort is to get people more connected. But most people, or many people in various cultures, their first priority, which is the priority of their nervous system, is to survive. And so we need the features in the environment to support a sense of safety. And there's actually a formula for this, and this is really part of what we will understand. The formula starts with the prosodic voice of the mother. The formula includes the predictability of safety around us, that is an empowerment of exploratory behavior as well. So if you check the developmental literature, there's the paradoxical situation of secure development results in expansive exploration and bolder behavior. And we also know that the educational system that we are part of and products of doesn't understand neurophysiological maturation, doesn't understand development, and doesn't respect individual differences, but lives on a behavioral model. And so the whole theme of my talk was that there's an intervening process, and that's our biology and our physiology. That's monitored, that's predictable, and that's manipulatable. Thank you.
This is just a further question to you. So if you've established that in society, that efforts to, you know, damp down the fear threat or the life danger would be effective, are you taking steps, or if you are, what are you doing to try to get that information into the right hands?
Well, there are two points there. One is getting the information, and that's what we're doing today and when we give our talks. The other part is that we don't live in a safe world. There are real dangers, and there is a need for people to be vigilant and to take care of us, that more ancient cultures were aware of this. They literally had, like, I use this term, I don't mean it in any disparaging way, they had a warrior class, but that actually freed other individuals to be artists, artisans, creatives, poets, and to experience life in a different way. In our view of democracy, it's really the democratic opportunity to be put in life-threat situations. And most of us are ill-prepared and epigenetically poorly developed for that type of situation.
Thank you for a series of great series of talks. Really very interesting and enlightening. As regards both the vagal nerve and oxytocin, so for the vagal nerve, a vagotomy has been a procedure that's been around for many years, although in different anatomical locations, but still occurs. And there are many different drugs that will interact with hormone secretion and or vagal tone. Can you talk a little bit about that? Because contemporary life is really filled with many pharmacologic and or surgical manipulations.
Yeah, I'll start with that. First, the vagotomy used to be done subdiaphragmatically off the gut, but what that was also disrespecting that 80% of the fibers of the vagus are sensory, so it actually fostered a disconnect between our viscera and our brain. So 80% of those fibers are promoting information that our brain is utilizing to help regulate the feedback loops that keep us healthy. So the first part is that vagotomies and even vagal nerve stimulations are a simplification of the model. I would much rather like to see vagal stimulation through neural exercises, which may be posture, breath, singing, in a sense, things that are physiologically informed, as opposed to basically shooting in the dark, because no one knows what the frequency of stimulation or the current of stimulation should work well. So they're using vagal nerve stimulators for depression. When asked what are the parameters of stimulation, they said, we borrowed those from the people who'd used it for epilepsy. So there's no, in a sense, true physiological model. So the first thing is we could inform the way that we treat things, not with pharmaceuticals, because as Sue was saying, it's the chronic use of drugs that are really problematic. Drugs are very good for acute changes, but chronically they actually affect feedback loops and potentially influence, have epigenetic consequences. So the chronic use of drugs, which is prevalent in our society, is a misunderstanding of how our nervous system evolved and how it works. The final part of that, actually another, can't remember it, so we'll give it to Sue.
Well, so we're out of time at this moment, so we'll end with Sue. Did you want to say something?
No, I just wanted to say that moral elevation is a pretty good exercise, and you don't even have to be able to move to have those experiences. I love Serena's work for that reason.
Well, thank you, panelists. Excellent discussion. Is anybody a fan of Hunter S. Thompson? You know, you were talking about chronic use of drugs. You know what Hunter said? He said, I don't advocate the use of drugs and alcohol, but they work for me. So now we're going to break for lunch.